Good morning again.
Good morning.
Praise His holy name.
Amen.
We pray that you're feeling Holy Spirit as much as I am. He is definitely active and moving. You've been paying attention, as Pastor Pat says so often, of what He's been doing and saying, your praises, the words that He has given me to share with you. Again, all comes together with no communication amongst us humans, just through our spirits, paying attention and listening to Him. Amen? This is the Word of God, inspired by God, our daily guide to righteous living. Amen? For those of you that will follow along, Deuteronomy. Chapter 6, verses 1 through 9. Deuteronomy 6, verses 1 through 9. Title of the sermon, What is in Your Heart? So let's read His Word. Verse 1, Now, this is the commandment, and these are the statutes and judgments which the Lord your God has commanded to teach you, that you may observe them in the land which you are crossing over to possess, that you may fear the Lord your God, and keep all His statutes and His commandments, which I command you, you and your son and your grandson, all the days of your life, and that your days may be prolonged. Therefore, hear, O Israel, and be careful to observe it, that it may be well with you, and that you may multiply greatly, as the Lord God of your fathers has promised you, a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. The word of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
That's the New King James Version. Well, it says right here in the text, teeth. So that's what I want to just sit down and to just teach what he's laid on my heart, which is the title of the sermon. So verse 4, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." Not many. You've heard me say that so many times. We don't have many gods. We have one God that we serve with our whole heart, our soul, and our strength. Not many. "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength." You see, when you're serving the Lord with all your heart, I'll back up and say when we first get here, some of us was at a fish fry last night with another church. And when you're talking like that, you're sharing what's on your mind. When you're just talking amongst one another, your daily events, what's happened. But when you sit down and you calm down and you talk to God, you're talking from your heart. It's no longer what's on your mind. And last week, Elohim Shammah was God's name last week that we went over. God hears. That's what that stands for. And I used a verse where that was at. It was the groaning of your heart. And it would not let loose of me all week. The groaning of your heart. So when you go to God in prayer, whether you know it or not, you're lifting up those things that went from your mind to your heart that you want Him to hear. Amen? And He's hearing. And not only hearing, He's moving and He's answering. So, do you know what's in your heart? Till you talk with God, I wonder. Till we start talking with God, do you know? Our heart is the center. It's our life. It's true feelings. And I just didn't know where to put this. So I'm going to come here and I'm going to let the Holy Spirit chase me around and use the words that He wants me to describe our one and only God. He is the maker of the heavens and the earth. He is our refuge. He's our strong tower. When the righteous run into Him, they are saved. He's holy, holy, holy. He's the great I Am. He's the one that will judge us all in our appointed time. The salt of the earth. He loves you more than you love yourself. Our Creator. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I wanted to say that. Teach you today that we have two of these that sit on our deck. window. And Holy Spirit brought that upon my mind. I just want to talk with God. And I felt it was so demeaning to just ask our Lord and Savior and our Jesus. Can we just sit in a rocking chair and just talk? He sits on the throne. And at his right hand, the Holy Spirit. And I thought, who am I to ask him to just come and sit in a rocking chair and just talk to me? And I couldn't even think of the word demeaning. So I wanted to lift him up in all the glory that he deserves and all the praise that you have brought off your lips today. But I left hundreds of descriptions out, but I left one out on purpose. Our Father. That's not the one who just brought me that, and I don't think I said it earlier. But he's our friend. He wants you to just talk to him. Talk from your heart to him. That's all prayer is. It's the Pharisees and Sadducees and all them that want to string all those big words together to impress one another. Doesn't impress our Lord and Savior. You just get in your rocking chair. Invite him. He'll sit right there with you. And he'll listen. And you can just talk. And just share your heart. Of how you really feel. And even if it's something that you don't think he wants to hear, tell him now. It'll release your heart, and it'll be a healing process that starts within you that you've never experienced before. None of that was in my notes. Praise his holy name. Thank you, Holy Spirit. And whether it's a rocking chair or a swing on a front porch, and I'm going to bring our pastor back in because I heard him say one time, that he's got, and I pray that God takes him to that stump. I remember in one of his sermons he talked about he just being get to that stump. He feels so much closer to God, and that he can just share his heart. I pray he gets there this weekend. So that's your heart, your soul. I really struggled with this one. So that was this morning's thing. Our soul. And of all things, right before we left, my wife was sharing something about there's some place that can look at your eyes and read your eyes. And they can tell you things about what's going on in your body. And I looked at her and I said, that's funny you would say that. Because the saying is, our eyes is the heart to our soul. It's the path of our soul. And they can look at your eyes. And we're going to do it. We know some people that have. That's on medications and different illnesses and things with their body. They didn't know those people. They went, had it done, and they told them to the ailment that they have. So our soul, it's all your being. Is your soul, body, spirit, and soul. There's three parts of the soul: intellect, emotions, and your will. That's called trichotomy. From the biology description. Listen closely to this. This just grasped me. The scientists, biology, all the things that keep trying to figure out our Lord and Savior. If they can't prove it in a lab, it doesn't exist in too many of their minds. Three groups, so this is the biology of the trilometry. Three groups of organisms share a common ancestor. But it is unclear or unknown in what order the three groups split. Body, soul, and spirit. With all your strength, whatever you have left over, and just this week, I heard from a professional yesterday a word that used to carry maybe more weight than it does today due to different circumstances of what professionals have told us in the past. But this guy was training high-end athletes. And he said, there's only two levels of strength. I do the first one really well. That's zero. So, I want to go on a walk every day, but I choose to just sit in my chair with a bag of chips and a Twinkie and a soda pop. That would be zero effort towards strength. Maybe you're ill. 100% strength in the training arena would be if your setups, if you're doing setups, you do setups to where you can set up. That is 100%, however many that is. Zero is you don't do any. 100% of your strength is when you cannot do one more. And then there's everything in between on that, and that's where it's not measurable. It's zero or 100. So we're to serve the Lord with all of our strength. What does that look like? In this scripture, I don't know that it says, but I go back to when our Lord and Savior was praying. And he took the disciples, and then he went further. And he asked them to stay awake. Now, I won't say they had zero strength, because I think they stayed awake for a while. But they went to sleep. He went and prayed so hard that blood was dripping. Now, I'd say that was probably as close to an example of 100% strength to pray for a situation that's in his life. I've prayed pretty hard and pretty long that I can fall asleep too. Amen? That's just an example that he brought to the forefront of my mind. And to serve the Lord with all of your heart, your soul, and your strength, he gave me two examples. With Abraham to sacrifice Isaac. And we've heard our pastor preach on that many a time. But you see, he had the focus and the trust in the Lord. That can you imagine that climb up that mountain with your son, your one and only son? The confusion, did I hear right? Will he provide? All the questions that our flesh, the turmoil that is going through, the terror that would have been going through his mind, that he trusted the Lord more than his flesh. And more importantly, he obeyed the command. Amen? The other example, so that's the good one. The other one was just in the book ahead of this one, in Exodus. When Moses is on the mountain, and that's kind of later in the sermon, getting the Ten Commandments. Less than 40 days, Aaron suggested and did they bring the jewelry, and he made a golden calf. So they could worship a God. He didn't have the Lord on the forefront, but yet he still let him in. So I'm interjecting this probably in the wrong area. But this is the point I want to make. What if this morning you got a call? All churches are shut down. There's not one church in this United States of America that's open. I have a phone app, Blue Letter Bible, that I read every day, virtually every day. Those apps are gone. Your Bibles that I'll say correcting right now will never disappear. There's three eternal things, our Lord and Savior, your spirit, and life is word. But for the sake of fitting this in, your Bibles are all gone. So now there's no church, there's no Word of God left. What would you do? Where would you go? We're still here. I think that's what he would be calling us, though. But we're still here. What would you do? Would you mourn over that phone call as much as if one of your children just passed away? Or your spouse? Because what they did is they just wiped everything away that we have to worship God with, other than your mind and your heart and your soul. It's in there. I wished I would take more time to memorize His Word. For that's what Paul did in prison. He didn't have any of that. He had it in his heart to worship the Lord, to sing praises to the Lord. And some of you watched me one time, probably 2 years ago. It embarrassed me, but I know I didn't embarrass the Lord when I was giving the scriptures as I did. I was trying to memorize them, stand right in front of there and repeat them to you without looking. I don't think I did one. I think I tried a dozen times at one. Just gave up. And that's just one verse on one morning. And I couldn't do it. And then I just gave up. Would you mourn because everything was just taken away from you? Would you notice at all as your Bibles open up, does an app open up during the week? How much time do we spend in prayer? Serving the Lord with all of our heart, soul, and strength. Okay, back to the scriptures. 6, and these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. And I know you all know what that means. That's all day long, no matter where you're at, no matter what time of day it is, to be teaching them. And not only is it teaching them the ways of the Lord and His Word and His loving kindness, it's reminding you. In a lot of our conversations, does the Lord even enter it? We're talking about our mind. There is many of you that could share the rest of this service about how good God has been to you, how He's healed you from a different disease, possibly cancer. Tell your children, tell your grandchildren how good God is. Remind them that He's alive and loves them. When you speak words like that, it reminds you. When you pray out loud, and I had that written down, it took my wife and I decades to learn to pray with one another. We'd pray for one another privately, but to pray with one another, I'll let you know right here and right now, your marriage will not get any stronger than if you do that. Because you can have your little differences, your little skirmishes, sometimes probably a tackle in the living room. That when you get beside your spouse and you hold hands and you go to our Lord God Almighty, all of that stuff starts melting away. And when Holy Spirit comes over you and you start appreciating your spouse for what they do and who they are and how they encourage you, maybe they don't right now, all the more reason to pray with one another, for one another. And if some of these prayer requests fall in line, all the better. Whether it's 2 minutes or several minutes, try and incorporate that in. You'll never get closer than that time right there, and all that other stuff just starts melting away. I'm going to get down to verse 8 and we're going to start closing this thing. There is so many things. And I forgot it before and I'm going to put it in here. Now I'm going to get verse 8. Verse 8. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. I literally almost broke down when a testimony in here said, bring it to the frontlet. Frontlet in that day was could be two things. A piece of cloth that was over the altar, or a band. A band or an ornament on your forehead. That's frontlet. I bring that up to say what my old pastor, Lowell Burris, bless his heart, is celebrating with our Lord and Savior now. His one comment of hundreds that he'd say as we talk about serving the Lord, he goes, "Show me your checkbook." And I'll tell you how you serve the Lord. What you think of Him. I've always thought long and hard about that. See, it isn't just the money you bring here. What else do you do with it? And many of you do many and great things. And it isn't all about money. You can serve the Lord our Jesus Christ without writing a check to anybody. But that's just an interesting statement. When our daughter was in college, I remember visiting her dorm room, and she had a mirror, you know, the size of a pickup hood to get all beautiful. But I had to look like that just to barely see my eyes. I don't know how she must have a little handheld one or something. On that mirror were sticky notes. Verses from the Bible. When she looked in that mirror, she was thinking about our Lord Jesus Christ and how to serve Him with her life and in college. In the forefront, it talks about the gates and our doorpost. You see, all of that is to bring it to the forefront of your mind. For whatever is at the forefront of your mind, if you keep it there long enough, Pastor Thad, 18 inches or 12, whatever it is, it's going to go from there to there. What are we keeping at the forefront of our mind? I had somebody else tell me about, "Show me your house instead of the checkbook." That's the gate. That's the entryway into your house. Just a few years ago, we went on a parade of homes in Warsaw, and they give you a sheet on which house you like the best, and the last one, and they're all big and they're magnificent in their own way, because that's the way they designed them. The last house, I don't know if it's the biggest, could have been, it's all immaterial. When you step foot through that front door of that house, and it could have been something even before you got there. When you stepped in that house, it was obviously large and magnificent. On the wall that you looked at, it had letters that big all the way across that wall of a Bible verse. I can't tell you what it was. But when you stepped into that house, you knew what that stood for. And they probably had 15, maybe 25 rooms, upstairs, downstairs, kitchens. They had Bible verses painted and scripted all over that house. What's on the forefront of your minds? What do you keep putting in your mind that's going to end up in your heart? The doorpost is the entrance. On the front that I've talked about, doorpost, gate of the house is material. Frontlet, soul. What enters the mind, enters the soul. It's eternal. So I pray that through this, we're keeping that on the forefront. the frontlets of your mind to serve our Lord and Savior with all your soul, your strength, and more importantly, your heart. What's in there will come out. In conclusion, serve God, what I just said, for the umpteenth time. Your heart, your soul, and all your strength. Give it your all. As long as you feel pain, you're still alive. As long as you make mistakes, thank you, Holy Spirit. As long as you make mistakes, you're still human. You heard me give two examples. The only person that I've read in the Bible that didn't make a mistake was our Lord Jesus Christ. He served to the end to die for sinners like us. So, you heard me say something about Aaron. Well, Aaron was the one that led him to the promised land. He made a mistake. So don't let your mistakes just take you, yeah, I've been there, I've done that, I tried to serve the Lord, it just don't work. I stood here a dozen times trying to memorize scripture. I couldn't for whatever reason, but I'm not going to give up just because I couldn't at one time. Don't ever give up. You have more strength than you think you have. And when you are out, go to the Lord. He's got enough strength for you. Don't let a mistake take you out of the Word, take you from sharing with your grandchildren and your children, or praying with your spouse. We tried many a times. We couldn't do it. For those that don't serve in ministry or don't pray for with one another, I always said, if you want your head caved in, become a head of something in ministry. Because you'll know what Pastor Thad goes through. Or anybody that gets up here to proclaim the Word of God. So when you start praying with one another, guess who's going to attack you? Because he wants you there, not there. So be prepared. And we always let him win. Because we wasn't mature enough to set beside one another and fight through that turmoil that he caused in our life. Don't ever let a mistake or a failure stop you from serving the Lord our Christ with all of your heart, all of your soul, and all of your strength. Amen? Because as long as you keep trying, there's hope. Amen? That's all I have. So if you give us a song, Aaron, I appreciate you. And if you'll come close to South.
Lord, we stand before you, and we thank you. We thank you for the messages you give us, for the messages that linger on our ears, that linger in our hearts, and that linger on our lips. Lord, help this message to go out into the world. Help this message to teach others what it truly means to give of everything to the Lord. Our everything is our heart. Our heart is what beats. Our heart is what moves us. Our heart is what helps us breathe. Our heart is the functioning tool of our body moves. Lord, if we're not giving you our heart, are we truly giving ourselves to you? for this message of today. As I know it humbled myself, I hope it humbled all of those sitting here today or listening over the internet. Lord, touch our lives in such a way that we know who you are, and we can give all of ourselves, our hearts, our souls, and all of our strength to you. Holy Spirit is laying upon my heart today. The conversation, it's easy to talk to Jesus. All you have to do is have a conversation. And if we return to our Bibles, the Lord shows us how to pray, how to talk, what to say. And so today I want to round out this prayer, Lord, with your prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us, Lord, from evil. For thine is the power, the glory,